Maybe it's because we're living in the evil timeline where George Bailey never existed and Mr. Spock has a beard, but I'm currently appreciating video games as a way to experience previous, more hopeful eras from history. We can play World War II shooters to remember a time of noble camaraderie and blitz spirit, Assassin's Creed 4 to live out a boyish dream of the golden age of piracy, and of course we have today's subject, Evil West, which immerses us in the wild and lawless days of 2010, when the Xbox 360 rode tall in the saddle and people really didn't expect much from their third-person shooters. Evil West is not to be confused with Weird West. This isn't one developer exclusively making cowboy games and doing the Sonic thing where they just take the recurring franchise word and bolt a second word on the end. The two games have absolutely no relation. If you're confused, just remember, weird is rubbing your scrotum up and down the inside of a tureen, evil is serving gravy to your in-laws out of it afterwards. Evil West is a third-person action-adventure about a government agency in Wild West times who must fight a secret war across the entire American continent against an organized race of vampires, despite only employing like two competent dudes who mostly hang out together, arguing over who has the most grizzled cowboy penis, and despite the agency's entire supply of weapons and gadgets being constantly worn by one of those dudes, so he waddles about the battlefield rattling like a dodgy shopping cart full of Lego. Said hero is Jesse Rentier, or Jesse Rentier. The voice actors never really reached a consensus on that one. Vampire hunter in the Hugh Jackman Van Helsing mold, but without the excuse of cold European weather to justify wearing the entire stock of a camping supply shop at once. Who refuses to take a desk job at HQ because he's a vampire hunter, cop on the edge, and they need him out on the streets, etc. And besides, he's got all their weapons strapped to his back, which would make it very difficult to sit in an office chair. Fortunately, the agency is driven onto the back foot by a coordinated vampire assault, and Jesse finds himself on the front lines of an all-out supernatural war, leading a now severely undermanned agency against the schemes of an insane vampire leader and the plans they have brewing behind their insidious magical glamour. Or glamour. That was the other thing the voice actors forgot to compare notes on. Happily, this is a war that can be fought by trudging through linear environments, getting into conveniently fenced-off battles with strictly regimented numbers of enemy units. So yeah, it's another Ghost Train Ride game where herds of wild contextual button prompts sweep majestically across the plains and then politely queue up to squeeze down narrow passages of every imaginable variety. But as implied earlier, setting aside, there's something terribly old-fashioned about Evil West that feels a bit PlayStation 3 era. A lot of that could be the story and the way it clunkily switches from gameplay to pre-rendered cutscene, where the camera zooms in too close on characters as they massively over-animate, so it looks like Paul Greengrass shooting a documentary on submarine crews with Parkinson's disease. Or maybe it's the fact that there's precisely one female character in the entire plot whose every other line of dialogue is complaining about how the boys don't take her seriously enough. Or just that the main character is a stock, squinty, grumbly badass whose usual contribution to exposition scenes is to grunt "English, Doc!" whenever one of his pet tech nerds starts using language roughly as advanced as that of an instruction pamphlet for an electric beard trimmer. So initially I was down on Evil West. The theme and setting and prominent crashed Zeppelin early in the plot brought back a few vestigial memories of the Order 1886 that I'd long thought solvent abuse had successfully quashed, and there's a general ramshackle vibe given off by the occasional awkward edit and frustratingly unoccasional bugs that meant I repeatedly clipped halfway into the floor and had to reload a save, either because of physics fuck-ups or the floor finally giving way under the weight of Jesse's anorak. But once I settled into the combat groove, I became aware of an upsetting sense that I was having fun against my will. It never stops being janky and unrefined, but that might be part of the appeal. It's not so much a finely crafted patisserie dessert as a big bucket of cake, candy bars, and whipped cream all smushed together. And I'm certainly not above enjoying such things, especially when bored, depressed, or pregnant. If there was ever a game crying out for some kind of spectacle fighter mechanic that rewards the player for varying their approach, it's this one, because by the end your available variety of attacks would shame a battleship crewed by poisonous hedgehogs. Standard punch, uppercut, electric punch, clearing electric punch, sneaky interrupt, kick in the bollocks, parry shield, electric lasso, six shooters, shotgun, rifle, crossbow, flamethrower, glory kills, super duper attack with 10-minute cooldown, I haven't even gotten to the facetious made-up examples yet, grenade launcher, minigun, hedge trimmer, angry cat in a bag, and there we go. Plus everything has the all-important satisfying feel, especially when you uppercut a dude into the air, jump up and pound him into the exploding barrel three of his mates were standing around for their weekly gasoline tasting. Your dude still moves around like he's got horny dogs trying to get off with both his legs, but he's also got an electric teleport and electric pull to swiftly move himself and his foes around. And it was, incidentally, the number one cause of unwanted floor intimacy, but the intention was solid. If there's anything that brings the combat down, in the non-floor related sense that is, it's overdoing it with the big damage spongy dudes in the game's back half. Almost every boss fight comes back later as a regular enemy, usually in numbers, and poor old Jesse Rentier gives himself repetitive strain injury biffing away at them. If you keep biffing them over and over again, it builds up the stun meter, you see, and once it fills up they stop moving for a bit so you can continue biffing them over and over again with slightly more confidence. But there are more than a few things to like about Evil West. It's silly overblown combat against big chunky targets, and it's fun, like covering yourself in grease and pogo sticking through a defrosting meat locker. Just me? Okay. Well, besides that, it frequently manages to be quite visually striking as well. I like its use of vibrant colours, which is another way it sets itself apart from Order 1886, which looked mostly like it had just had the dust blown off it after 100 years in the back room of an antique shop run by people allergic to fun. And as I say, it did feel like stepping momentarily back to the late 2000s era for a week. There's even a multiplayer option on the title screen. I can't remember the last time I saw that. A single-player game with an included, entirely separate multiplayer mode that doesn't try to awkwardly smash smash them together into a live-service grinder-thon. That certainly does evoke a bygone age. Thanks for the memories, Evil West. You gonna try out the multiplayer mode?
Nope.